I was thinking about some of the guys I went to high school with. And this week, I was thinking about a guy who was one of the best athletes. In fact, he was the best athlete in our class. Tremendous baseball player. Had major colleges all over the country after him. And the guy had tremendous potential. Power, his power was unbelievable. And he got a full ride, went to Stanford. And he had a great time at Stanford. Not playing baseball. Because he didn't last long at Stanford. You know what happens. You know the drill. You get into college, and what do? You start partying. And you got a great opportunity. The whole thing's covered. But, man, you're away from home, and your folks aren't telling you what time to come in. And he just kind of went crazy and partied, and his grades just dropped out, and then they threw him out. And it was at the height of the Vietnam War, and within a couple of months, he was snatched up and on his way to Vietnam. I remember getting a call from a friend who said that Bob was at Oakland Naval Hospital, and we lived in the Bay Area. I said, really, what happened? And he said, well, he's in pretty bad shape. And so I went over to see him. And it had been months since he had been wounded. I walked in, he was coherent. He was actually pretty calm and pretty engaging. And I said, so Bob, what happened? And he said, well, Steve, it was my first day there. And what happened was I stepped on a landmine. And all the guys around me, because that landmine, the way it was constructed, it goes out. And the guys around me, I can't remember if he said six guys or seven or eight, I can't remember. They were all killed. I said, it's amazing you survived, isn't it? He goes, amazing. And then he threw back the covers off his bed. And all he had on were boxers. And the only thing I can tell you, it looked like he had zippers all over his body, zippers. A zipper here with here, and then this arm, same thing. His chest, three zippers. It's where they went in to get shrapnel. Legs, back of his legs, back. He was gonna walk again. Baseball was over, but we just sat there for about, I don't know, 45 minutes, for an hour, and talked, and he said, you know, Steve, honestly, there was a wire. He said, I've been over this 100 times. He said, I never saw it. I thought I was paying attention, but I tripped that wire. A number of years ago, I wrote a book up in my bedroom called Point Man. And it was a book for men, and the subtitle of the book was How a Man Can Lead a Family. If I were writing that book today, I would change the subtitle. I would change the subtitle from How a Man Can Lead a Family to How a Man Can Lead a Family in a Hostile Culture. Because, as we've talked about before, from where we were 30 years ago and where we are now, everything has changed. Where we were 10 years ago, where we were 5 years ago, where we were 8 years ago, everything has changed. And not for the better, for the worse. How a man can lead a family in a hostile culture? America has always been a place of religious liberty and freedom, but in recent years, no. In fact, if you're a Christ follower, and it's clear that you are, you're going to get some heat, and you're going to get some flack. If you take a stand on a principle, you might be called a hater, just simply because you're following Christ. That's never happened before in this country. If you think marriage is between a man and a woman, there's something wrong with you. You're not normal. You're a problem if you think marriage is between a man and a woman. Yet for thousands and thousands of years, in every culture on the face of the earth, there's only been one definition of marriage. It's between a man and a woman, period. But no longer. And if you don't agree to any kind of marriage, you're going to get some hostility. Gender. Gender is a pretty simple concept. I remember reading a book about 30 years ago by a psychologist in Marin County, the county north of San Francisco, a very wealthy county, very progressive, very liberal. And he was talking about, this was 30, 35 years ago, he was talking about feminism, he was talking about the mindset of some who were even having a problem with gender, with male and female. This was 35 years ago. And talking about some extreme people with some extreme views, someone who he was counseling. Now, 35 years ago, this wasn't on the radar, but he was seeing the first shots across the bow. And I remember this person was a female, as he talked about her, and found herself pregnant and decided she was going to give that child, raise that child, not in a context of male or female, if it's a boy, not give it, you know, toy soldiers, or if it's a girl, not make her play with dolls, you know, none of that gender stuff. Yet, when she went into labor and when that baby was delivered, after all that pain and all that anguish and that baby came out, the first words out of her mouth was, "What is it? What is it?" Now, this guy wasn't a Christian, but he had enough sense to say, "This is nonsense." And now it's an entire industry. And now people's lives are being broken and shattered and destroyed left and right by confusion over gender. You see, and if you say it's male, female, you're going to get some hostility. You see, this is where we are. Yeah, if I were to write Point Man now, it wouldn't be how a man can lead a family. It would be how a man can lead a family in a hostile culture. And I would pose that question. We're in a hostile culture. The question is, how do you lead a family in a hostile culture? There is an answer in Scripture. And it is Ephesians chapter 5. And I'd like you to turn with me, and specifically tonight we're going to hone in on verses 15, 16, 17, and 18. And we're going to start a new series tonight. And I'm going to call this series Landmines. And if it had a subtitle, I would subtitle it Walking Wisely in Evil Days. Because this is where we are. Ephesians 5, beginning with verse 15, he says this: "Therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time, because the days are evil." Our days are evil. I've mentioned this before several times. In 1959, Martin Lloyd-Jones, who was pastor of Westminster Chapel in London, got up before his congregation, and Lloyd-Jones said to his congregation in 1959, he said, "We are living in days of exceptional evil." At 1959. From our perspective, 1959 were the golden years. 59 was Father Knows Best. 1959 was Bonanza. It was Little Joe and Hoss and Adam riding their horses around Lake Tahoe. I mean, the free speech movement in Berkeley hadn't even started in 59, as I recall.